Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome to the Foreign Service Institute's Mabini Dialogue series. Today's Mabini Dialogue will focus on the Philippines-Kazakhstan relations, specifically on the realities, prospects, and challenges. This dialogue will provide an overview of the government and society of Kazakhstan, its foreign policy, history, and its role in Central Asia and the region. More importantly, it will also explore opportunities for further cooperation between the Philippines and Kazakhstan. To give the opening remarks is Assistant Secretary Melissen Cruz Paredes of the Department of Foreign Affairs, Office of Asia and the Pacific Affairs. So prior to being Assistant Secretary of ASPA, she served as a Senior Special Assistant and Deputy of the APEC SOM Chair during the Philippine Chairmanship of APEC in 2015. She also served as the Assistant Secretary of the Department's Office of International Economic Relations. She has served in other capacities and in various foreign posts since she joined the Foreign Service. Assistant Secretary Cruz Paredes has a degree in economics from the University of the Philippines and pursued graduate studies in Oxford University. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Assistant Secretary Melissen Cruz Paredes.
His Excellency Ambassador Ascat Orasbay, His Excellency Ambassador Usen Sulaiman, Mr. Shavkat Sabirov, Ambassador Claro Cristobal, friends from business community, academia, and think tanks, colleagues in the Department of, from the Department of Foreign Affairs and other agencies, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is my privilege to welcome you to the Mabini Dialogue on the Roundtable on Philippines-Kazakhstan Relations, Realities, Prospects, and Challenges. First and foremost, allow me to thank Director General Claro Cristobal and the staff of the Foreign Service Institute, which co-organized this important event. I would also like to thank Ambassador Orasbay, Ambassador Sulaiman, and Mr. Sabirov for coming all the way from Jakarta, Singapore, and Almaty, respectively, to join us today as guest speakers. It is indeed providential that this roundtable discussion comes on the heels of the 25th anniversary last 19 March of the establishment of the diplomatic relations between the Philippines and Kazakhstan. I wish to note that since the establishment of our relations, the friendship between the Philippines and Kazakhstan has been continuing to deepen and blossom. One of the most important milestones in our relations is the visit to the Philippines of His Excellency President Nursultan Nazarbayev on 10 to 12 November 2013, when a number of agreements and documents were signed, including the Memorandum of Agreement between the Philippines and Kazakhstan on cooperation in the field of tourism, the Memorandum of Agreement between the Philippines and Kazakhstan on visa exemption for holders of diplomatic and official passports, as well as a joint declaration on friendship and cooperation between the Philippines and Kazakhstan. Another significant landmark in our bilateral relations is the inaugural Philippines-Kazakhstan political consultations that was held on the 1st of October 2014. The consultations discussed cooperation in the areas of trade and investment, energy and education, among other issues. Another anticipated high point in our relations is the Philippines' participation in the International Exhibition Expo 2017 in Astana from the 10th of June to the 10th of September 2017, with theme and focus on renewable energy. Energy Secretary Alfonso Cusi signified his intent to attend the opening ceremonies of the expo, while the Department of Tourism also conveyed its plan to participate in the international exhibition. Despite these important landmarks, however, there are a lot of untapped opportunities to explore at the political, economic, and socio-cultural fronts. Our relationship is 25 years old, young by some accounts, but with sufficient foundation to explore deeper and more extensive links. Bilateral trade, for example, is only at $245,778. With this figure, Kazakhstan is the Philippines' 167th trading partner out of 220 countries. And last year, 2016, there was no inflow or outflow of foreign direct investment. So these figures indicate that we need to start somewhere and do a lot of work to grow this vital sector. This is exactly the reason for convening this roundtable discussion. We bring together people of different backgrounds and interests in one room to learn more and act on these opportunities. Our speakers, Ambassador Orazbay, Ambassador Suleiman, and Mr. Sabirov, will help us appreciate and understand our country more by presenting not only an overview of Kazakhstan foreign policy, history, and role in Central Asia, but also the realities and challenges in improving the economic connectivity between the Philippines and Kazakhstan. For the Philippines, Kazakhstan is a key player in Central Asia and a prospective significant economic player. We appreciate its potential and would like to see synergy between us across the board so that we can harness our intellectual, human, and material resources to build a robust relationship and cultivate a deep friendship. We also understand that improving and enhancing our political, economic, and socio-cultural linkages will be beneficial for both peoples of Philippines and Kazakhstan. We have an amazing panel of speakers today, and we want to learn from them and learn from each other. So thank you very much, and I look forward to meaningful and fruitful discussions today. Thank you very much.
So ladies and gentlemen, to introduce our speakers and to moderate the succeeding discussion, I would like to call Director Jeffrey P. Salik. Director Salik is currently with the Department's Office of Asia and Pacific Affairs, where he oversees South Asia and Central Asia Division. Previously, he was also an acting director at the DFA's Office of the Middle East and African Affairs, and was also previously Third Secretary and Vice Consul in the Philippine Embassy in Amman, Jordan. Likewise, he has served in various foreign posts and in various capacities since he joined the Philippine Foreign Service. Director Salik has a Master's of Science in Economics from the Erasmus University Rotterdam and a Bachelor's Degree in Business Administration from the University of the Philippines. So ladies and gentlemen, Director Salik.
Thank you, RJ. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The Mabini Dialogue on the Roundtable on Philippines-Kazakhstan Relations, Realities, Prospects, and Challenges is divided into two main parts. The first session this morning will focus on Kazakhstan's general political profile, brief history, Kazakhstan 2050, multi-vector foreign policy, as well as Kazakhstan's five top priorities. The session in the afternoon will focus on the economic profile of Kazakhstan in terms of its GDP mix, degree of competitiveness, priority sectors, and latest economic strategies being undertaken by the government. This morning's session will have two speakers. Our first speaker is a well-seasoned career diplomat and concurrently the ambassador of Kazakhstan to Indonesia and non-resident ambassador to the Philippines. He was previously assigned in Iran and Turkmenistan. He studied Oriental Studies at the Tashkent State University. Aside from Kazakh and English, he also speaks Russian, Turkish, and Persian. Without further ado, let us please welcome His Excellency Ambassador Asghat Orazbay.
Kazakhstan, where history has been written on the windblown steppe and the future glitters in thousands of lights on the horizon. For Kazakhstan, the ninth largest country in the world, its past has surely informed the indomitable spirit it exhibits today. From the wild horses and endless steppe that symbolize nomadic freedom, to the rapidly growing infrastructure and vibrant cities the country knows now, Kazakhstan has evolved and adapted to become successful, stable, and independent, not in spite of its history, but because of it. According to ancient writings, the Kazakhs were valiant and courageous, innovative, adaptable. They played a defining role in shaping Central Eurasia. Today, what's past is prologue, as Kazakhstan again takes center stage as a dynamic leader in the region. Kazakhstan has seen its share of invaders and marauders, but it has also seen the influx of diverse peoples and religions. Today, Kazakhstan, a country of more than 100 ethnic groups and 17 religions, is well known for its religious tolerance and ethnic diversity. Historically, this former breadbasket of the Soviet Union was also a large producer of metals, coal, oil, and livestock products. Today, this abundance of natural resources is at the heart of the Kazakh economy. During the Soviet rule, the country suffered some of its greatest losses. The Soviet nuclear weapons testing program, conducted over a 40-year period at the Semipalatinsk test site, caused unimaginable human and environmental devastation. Generations of Kazakhs have paid and are still paying the price in cancer, birth defects, death and disease. The nation has renounced the world's fourth largest nuclear arsenal and has taken a leading role on the issue of nuclear responsibility, advocating global nuclear disarmament with a strong voice and absolute moral authority. During its 550 years of established statehood history, the nation has experienced adversity and even atrocity, but it has prevailed. It has always prevailed. After centuries of political, economic, and cultural crises, Kazakhstan came into its own. Its independence was proclaimed in 1991. Under the leadership of its first president, Nursultan Nazarbayev, Kazakhstan has seen unparalleled progress. Viewed through the prism of the past, this progress is reflected in many ways. Religious tolerance, adaptability, hospitality, patience, international diplomacy, innovation, strength, all inform today's Kazakhstan. A willingness to see all sides, the propensity to balance and dialogue, the sense to not choose east over west, north over south, has made Kazakhstan an example of stable growth that any up-and-coming nation would do well to emulate. From the past comes a sense of purpose and a desire for progress and peace. On a clear day, there is no sky more blue, no clouds more majestic than those rolling over the steppe or kissing the peaks of the Tian Shan Mountains. Kazakhstan also boasts emerald green pine forests and miles of deep canyons, where the light plays red and gold, and shadows cast a spell on anyone with a view to the canyon walls. The mountains host a variety of adventurers in every season, from skiing, snowboarding and skating, to hiking, riding and camping. Kazakhstan offers something for everyone. As host of the 2011 Asian Winter Games, the nation declared itself as a world-class destination for sporting events. Building on that success, Almaty has bid to host the 2022 Winter Olympics. But apart from the varied and stunning natural beauty of the country, cities have grown. Infrastructure has increased a thousandfold, along with the equally impressive Kazakh economy. And infrastructure will grow even further when the country implements its new economic policy, Nurli Zol, over the next 3 years, making Kazakhstan even more of a major land bridge in the heart of Eurasia. Astana, the sparkling, nascent capital of Kazakhstan, sits on the steppe as a concrete symbol of progress and innovation. High-rise buildings and green space mingle with the new but historically minded Opera House and the presidential residence, the Akorda. Massive shopping malls rise up alongside the ultra-modern Peace and Harmony Palace Pyramid. The vision of the country's president, Astana is fulfilling its promise as a progressive modern metropolis. The city is also home to Nazarbayev University. The importance of education to the country is reflected in its 99.7% literacy rate, one of the highest in the world. Almaty, about 1,300 kilometers to the south of Astana, is the banking and trade center of the country. Kazakhstan also boasts beautiful mosques, churches, and synagogues that are representative of Kazakhstan's policy of religious and ethnic tolerance. In fact, Kazakhstan initiated and hosts triannual congresses of leaders of world and traditional religions, with the fifth one in 2015. The past and present meet on the grasslands, in the mountains, and now in the bustling cities. The stories and promises are whispered through the canyons as Kazakhstan continues to build a new Silk Road, an international center for trade and commerce, and a new legacy for the 21st century. Peace and harmony, however, don't just come with tolerance and cooperation. The people of the world must be fed, body, mind, and spirit. That's why, along with nuclear security, food, water, and energy security are all top priorities for Kazakhstan. They constitute Kazakhstan's bid for its non-permanent membership in the United Nations Security Council for 2017-2018. The country promotes science and technology programs across the nation and around the world. In fact, in a few years' time, Kazakhstan will host an international specialized exhibition, Expo 2017, the theme of which is Future Energy. 2014 to 2024 has been designated as the UN Decade of Sustainable Energy for All. That's why Kazakhstan is opening doors to wind, solar, and other alternative energy technologies, while also developing its massive petroleum, natural gas, and mineral extraction industries. The miles of open steppe make the perfect solar and wind energy labs. Kazakhstan's Green Bridge Initiative, supported by the UN Rio Plus 20 conference, is another important initiative being undertaken in Kazakhstan. As the world's largest landlocked country, Kazakhstan has never taken water for granted. That's why the country is focused on developing new systems, technologies, and international relationships for securing the world's water supply. Kazakhstan has transformed from a recipient to a donor of international aid. As one of the most dynamically growing economies, with a double-digit GDP per capita growth during its independence and leading rates in foreign investment influx in the region, Kazakhstan announced the launch of a KazAid official development assistance program. In fact, it has been more than 6 years since the country began providing assistance in the region and to Afghanistan. The prism of progress is a complex set of angles and lines that connect past to present and present to future. It reflects and refracts the ideals and ideas, values and actions that carry your nation forward, that coalesce into a clear vision for the future. For Kazakhstan, that vision has been hard won through the ages. But the strife known by the people has also created a sense of shared responsibility, a sense of place and purpose and drive that inspire the nation to take its lessons beyond its borders to the world. When today goes into the history books, Kazakhstan will have written many chapters about peace and progress, innovation and ideas. These values were born upon the steppe by the people who set their eyes on a bright new horizon and a world of endless possibility.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellency, Nilsen Cruz, Paredes, Assistant Secretary, Your Excellency, Director General Cristobal, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me, on behalf of the delegation of the Republic of Kazakhstan, to express our gratitude for organizing today's roundtable discussion devoted to Kazakhstan and inviting us to be speakers today. I, in particular, want to express my appreciation to Mr. Jeffrey and his team, our distinguished colleagues from the Department of Foreign Affairs, who made possible this event to happen today. And we are very pleased to be in beautiful city of Manila. And thank you for all arrangements done by the colleagues from the department and for your hospitality and generosity. I think it is a very wise and far-sighted approach because Kazakhstan is one of the world's rapidly developing economies with very bright development perspectives, which has a lot to offer to its foreign friends and partners, and to the Philippines in particular. Kazakhstan is the ninth largest country in the world in terms of territory. It is 2.7 million square kilometers, and it is geographically it is situated exactly in the center of Eurasian continent. It is really Eurasian country. That's why we call Kazakhstan heart of Eurasia. With 90% of territory lying in Asia, well, around 10% in Europe. That's why, by the way, Kazakhstan plays football in European UEFA Federation, not in Asia. So the reason why the European countries agreed to adopt Kazakhstan into UEFA was the fact that some part of the territory is located in Europe, geographically speaking. And that's why our people, they share both Western and Eastern values. It is a country where, let's say, traditional Western values very harmoniously coexist with traditional Islamic values. We are predominantly Muslim country, but very moderate, very liberal Muslim society. This factor has hugely influenced our people to become very cosmopolitan and tolerant. Our country is a unitary state with a presidential form of government. According to our constitution, the state proclaims itself a democratic, secular, legal, and social state. One of the most important components of Kazakhstan governance model is the role of the leader. Doubtless to say that the first president of Kazakhstan, His Excellency Nursultan Nazarbayev, has been influencing on the revival of Kazakhstan's statehood after the collapse of the Soviet Union, as well as on socio-political and socio-economic life of the country as a whole. Although Kazakhstan's population is not too big, just under 18 million of people, it is a home for more than 130 ethnic groups and nationalities, and 18 religious confessions. As I mentioned already, more than 70% of the population, they are Muslim. On the same time, we have quite sizable Russian community as a legacy of the former Soviet Union, and smaller communities of other ethnic groups like Uzbek, Ukrainians, Uyghurs, Tatars, Koreans, and Germans. But despite being a multi-ethnic society, Kazakhstan, unlike some other countries, has avoided ethnic and religious clashes. Being a Muslim country, Kazakhstan has successfully ensured inter-ethnic and inter-religious harmony. Kazakhstan began its statehood as far as back as 1465, when our first forefathers, Hans Janibek and Han Kurey, founded the Kazakh Khanate on the territory of modern Kazakhstan, which existed until the mid of 19th century, and last year marked the 550th anniversary of our statehood. In 1991, after breakdown of the former Soviet Union, Kazakhstan regained its independence. Since then, our country has managed to implement massive economic reforms and huge privatization of state assets, and to turn its economy from a communist-style planned economy into a free market economy. Actually, in 2001, Kazakhstan was the first country among former Soviet Union republics to be recognized by the United States of America and by the European Union, has been recognized as the first country with a free, open market economy. Throughout the period of independence, Kazakhstan has ensured political stability and managed to solve all territorial disputes with its neighboring countries by setting down boundary delimitation, including with Russia and China. We have the longest border, common border with Russia, 7,500 kilometers. It's actually, it is recorded in the Guinness book, and it's longer than US-Canada border, which many think is the longest. It's not, it is not. And with China, we have more than 1,500 kilometers of common border. So in the outset of our independence, so we managed to solve all the disputes and sign the treaties and ratified in the parliaments. So since then, we have no territorial disputes with none of our neighbors, and that's why we enjoy only friendly, reliable relationships with all our neighboring countries, including Russia and China. One of the big achievements of independent Kazakhstan is the new capital, Astana. You have just seen some pictures of our new capital, which was built in a record-breaking time from scratch, in spite of all difficulties of the transitional period after collapse of the Soviet Union and transition from the previous system to the new independent country. And less than in 10 years, we have managed to build an absolutely new and modern capital, Astana. Today, Astana is the venue of various high-level meetings and forums where many historical decisions are made. This year, Astana will host the international exhibition, Expo 2017, with the theme, The Future Energy, which will gather leaders and representatives from all over the world. As you may know, Expo, it is international exhibition which is held normally once in 3 years. The previous exhibition was in Milano in Italy, 2017 Astana, Kazakhstan, and the next one will be in 2020 in Dubai, United Arab Emirates. Over 25 years of independence. And as Assistant Secretary already mentioned, our embassy can wait an official invitation from the government of Kazakhstan to His Excellency Secretary Kusi. And we got some unofficial information that Mr. Kusi accepted the invitation, and we expect, hopefully, Mr. Kusi, the Minister of Energy of Philippines, and his accompanying delegation to participate in the opening ceremony on the 10th of June this year in Astana, and we expect a lot of heads of states and governments from foreign countries. So I hope Mr. Kusi will will represent Philippines not only in his capacity of the Minister of Energy, but also as a leader, one of the leaders of the ruling party. So we expect also him to meet his counterparts from our ruling party, Nurotan. over 25 years of independence, Kazakhstan has made a huge breakthrough in its socio-economic development. Despite having a very challenging way of its evolution, the country has achieved quite a lot. Today, Kazakhstan is a leading country in our respective region in Central Asia in terms of economic development and high GDP growth. So far, Kazakhstan has been the only net contributor to the development of other Central Asian countries, our neighboring countries, including Afghanistan. Kazakhstan is also the second biggest economy among former Soviet countries after Russia, and the most favorable country for foreign investors. So actually, during the Soviet time, Ukraine, during the existence of the Soviet Union, Ukraine was known to be the second largest economy among former Soviet Republic, but we overtook Ukraine a few years ago, and now we are the biggest economy in terms of size after Russian Federation. In its famous ranking Ease of Doing for 2017, the World Bank has placed Kazakhstan on the 35th position, 35, among 190 countries. By creating a very favorable investment climate, Kazakhstan until now has attracted up to $300 billion of USD direct foreign investment, and not only in oil and gas industry, but also in other spheres, which led us to diversify our economy. We are currently developing a big number of new industries in Kazakhstan, which have never existed before in our country. Such a progress has allowed Kazakhstan to set an ambitious goal to join the top 30 of the world's most developed countries by 2050. In order to achieve that aim, Kazakhstan has been constantly improving and reforming its economy. With that purpose, our president has adopted several strategic programs, laying down clear measures for its achievement. In January this year, the president, Nursultan Nazarbayev, made his annual address to the people of Kazakhstan, whereby proclaiming the third modernization of our country. In conducting the new modernization, primary attention will be given to five main priorities, such as accelerated technological modernization of the economy, dramatic improvement and extension of business environment, macroeconomic stability, improvement of quality of the human capital, and institutional transformation, security, and combating corruption. I hope my colleagues will give more detailed information about this program later on. Besides improving the economy, advancement of governing system and further democratization of the country has been always on the main focus of our leadership. Since the outset of independence, Kazakhstan has been a country with a strong presidential authority, which was needed when we started building up our newly emerged country. But after 25 years of independent development, in January this year, the president made a decision for the first time to share around 40 of his functions and authorities with the parliament and the government of Kazakhstan. It is an unprecedented step, given the fact that an opposite trend is taking place in some other countries. By doing so, it is expected that the political system of Kazakhstan will get more democratized, the control of the parliament over the government of the cabinet will strengthen, roles of parliament and government will increase, and an appropriate system of checks and balances will be created. As the result of that reform, the parliament will be empowered to negotiate with the government's structure with the president and will increase control over the cabinet of ministers, including in particular by simplifying procedure of vote of no confidence, as well as it will get greater authority over provincial government. The government or the cabinet of ministers will obtain more power and authority to manage social and economic development in Kazakhstan, will independently approve state programs. The president, as a head of state, will only focus on strategic matters like foreign policy, the national security, by keeping a role of supreme arbiter between the different branches of power of the government. We strongly believe that by successful modernization of the economy and advancement of the governmental system, Kazakhstan will strengthen its role as a leader of our region of Central Asia and will be able to contribute even more to regional and global peace and security. It should be noted that issues of peace and security have always been a top priority for Kazakhstan since the outset of independence. Its first contribution to the global security was made in 1991 by closing the Semipalatinsk nuclear test site and voluntarily giving up the fourth largest nuclear arsenal in the world in 1991. Since then, Kazakhstan has been a recognized leader in nuclear security and non-proliferation. And Kazakhstan's main achievement in this path is the Universal Declaration for the Achievement of a Nuclear Weapons Free World, initiated by Kazakhstan and co-sponsored by 35 countries in the United Nations General Assembly in December 2015. Along with nuclear security, Kazakhstan also attaches great importance to the global problems of energy, food, and water security, which have a growing impact on development and stability. Therefore, food, water, and energy security, along with nuclear security, are the key priority areas of Kazakhstan's non-permanent membership in the United Nations Security Council, which we started in January this year, 2017. Realizing that energy will have a great impact on our collective security in the future, Kazakhstan has chosen the theme Future Energy for the World Exhibition Expo 2017, as already mentioned, to be held this year in Astana from 10th of June until 10th of September. We expect to draw up to 5 million visitors, both local and foreign, from all participating countries and international organizations during the period of Expo. Until today, we have 115 countries and 18 international organizations who already confirmed their participation in the exhibition. Unfortunately, Philippines is not among them, but we are still. But it's due to objective reasons. I personally was in Manila last year, and I met officials, including from energy ministry and foreign ministries, trying to convince and encourage them to make favorable decision. But they reasonably told that, you know, the Mr. Aquino was outgoing president on that time, the cabinet was supposed to change, and then they thought we leave it to the new government to decide, which was very reasonable, understandable. We understand the situation, and I'm very much grateful to Indonesia, in particular to Secretary Kusi, as I mentioned already, for accepting. And there are still some hope that some Filipino companies can participate and represent Philippines in Expo. So I'm supposed to meet Secretary Kusi hopefully tomorrow, so I will discuss the details, how can we accommodate Philippines' desire to attend. Since Expo 2017 in Astana is going to be the largest global showcase in 2017, with over 3,000 events to be held in Astana during 93 exhibition days. And it will be useful for the Philippines, as I mentioned, in terms of promotion and marketing, business opportunities and research assessment of market opportunities. Attending meetings with the government of Kazakhstan, corporate and official participants of Expo will present a special opportunity for establishment of new business business links and extension of existed ones. So in case of the Philippines' participation in the upcoming Expo, we could significantly intensify our bilateral relations, which do not match, unfortunately, the existing potentials of our countries. Assistant Secretary already mentioned, I have a little bit different figure, but it's not a big issue. Anyway, the volume of trade turnover between our countries is very, very low. That's why we hope that participation of His Excellency Alfonso Cusi, Energy Secretary, will be very useful to establish business links between two countries, not only in the energy sector, but also in others. Since Kazakhstan is part of Eurasian Economic Union, which we created recently with a membership of countries like Russia, Belarus, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and Armenia. So five countries with a common market and capacity of more than 200 million people. Otherwise, Kazakhstan alone is not considered to be a very big market for businesses from big countries like Indonesia, for example, or Philippines, because we have population more than 17 million. But our membership in the Eurasian Economic Union, it provides wider market, taking into account that the population of Russia alone is more than 130 or 40 million. So this business, the potential prospective business for Indonesian companies will be useful from this point of view. They will get access not only to the Kazakhstan market, but also to Russian and some other countries. Today we have all opportunities to increase our trade cooperation between Kazakhstan and Philippines. Kazakhstan, as you may know, has huge reserves of wheat. We are big producer and exporter of wheat, and we consume only maybe less than 30% of the wheat which we produce. So we have big capacity to export, in particular to countries situated in the tropical zones like Philippines and Indonesia, because due to the climate conditions you cannot grow the wheat. But in view of huge population, 250 million Indonesia, more than 100 million in Philippines and other countries. So it's very huge market, and Filipino business people can negotiate with our producers and exporters. So I hope that it will be on the agenda of our bilateral economic cooperation projects. In particular, the trade, and we understand there are some objective difficulties to make business between our country, which is, it has very long distance between our countries. But recently, Kazakhstan has built necessary infrastructure and necessary facilities, terminal, storages, etc., in Chinese city of Liaoyungan, which is very relatively small city in the eastern coast of China, not far from Qingdao, if I'm not wrong, the province. It's relatively near to Shanghai, if you want to imagine. So we already developed, it's complete, the project completed. So we spent huge money from Kazakhstan budget to develop the infrastructure. And the main objective of this program is specifically increase cooperation, trade cooperation with Southeast Asian countries, including Philippines. Actually, Philippines geographically is the nearest country to Lianyungan, much more closer than, let's say, Malaysia or Thailand or Indonesia. So this can be very big advantage for prospective Filipino companies who want to make business with Kazakhstan then, because the distance from Lianyungan to Philippines, to Manila in particular, is much more shorter than to Jakarta or Kuala Lumpur, for example. But it's going to be a combined, a multi-transport scheme, because we are already connected with China through huge railway network, already existed for a long time. And we can transport our goods from Kazakhstan, from any city or any province of Kazakhstan, up to Lianyungan. We are already connected by railway. And from Lianyungan, by ship, to continue to Philippines, Malaysia, etc. So this project is very important for Kazakhstan, and we already completed recently. So we hope it will be operational very soon, and it will give more incentive to Filipino businessmen to make business directly with Kazakhstan, and will significantly decrease the transportation fee. And they can import, for example, the wheat from Kazakhstan. We also export high quality, premium quality meat, beef, lamb, etc. And Filipino in return can import to Kazakhstan tropical fruits or let's say textile production or whatever. So it's up to business people to decide how to cooperate, but responsibility of the government was to create favorable conditions and environment to make this business operations possible. Kazakhstan is indeed interested in developing bilateral cooperation with all countries in Southeast Asia, including with the Philippines. And we clearly stated about it in our new concept document, concept of new foreign policy of Kazakhstan adopted in 2014. Kazakhstan is therefore very much interested in developing long-term partnership and mutually beneficial relations with the Philippines. So, as you may see, Kazakhstan has crossed a quarter century period of its independence, being a politically stable, peaceful, and predictable country. Unlike some other our countries, Kazakhstan is a very peaceful country. We have no terrorist activities in our country. There's no terrorist group. All Muslim organizations, very tolerant, very moderate, and very liberal, and very civilized. So we have no terrorist groups or activities in Kazakhstan, which also contribute to creating suitable and favorable environment, which attracts a lot of foreign direct investment. That's why for young country with relatively small population, to attract in very short period of time 300 billion USD of FDI, it is already indication of stability, of the fact that the foreign investors, including big ones from America, UK, etc., confidence over the future of their business in Kazakhstan, safety and protection of the investment in Kazakhstan. So we hope this factor will encourage Filipino companies also to invest in Kazakhstan or make some joint projects, implement joint projects with their counterparts in Kazakhstan. So we hope that Kazakhstan's new stage of development will be inseparably linked to the intensification of its relations with the Philippines. So, in view of the limited time, so I will stop here, and I hope to be able to answer your questions later on, according to our agenda. And now, I just want to say thank you for your attention, and once again, I want to take this opportunity to really express our satisfaction and proud that Kazakhstan, Republic of Kazakhstan, has been chosen by the Department of Foreign Affairs as the first country to which you'll devote this round, this kind of round tables. So we hope to continue in the future, in particular our embassy in Jakarta. I'm recently visiting quite frequently Manila, so we constantly stay in touch with the Department of South and Central Asia, and hope we will continue. Thank you once again for your attention.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Orasbay, for that very interesting and informative talk and short video on Kazakhstan. I am sure some of you have questions, but we will be entertaining them after the presentation of the second speaker. Our next speaker is also an excellent career diplomat who is currently Kazakhstan's ambassador to Singapore. He was previously assigned in Iran, Turkmenistan, China, and Austria. He has a PhD from Hong Kong University and a master's degree in international affairs from Columbia University. He is fluent in Kazakh, Russian, English, and speaks some Persian and Chinese. Please welcome His Excellency Ambassador Usen Suleiman.
Good morning. Excellency Assistant Secretary Melissian Paredes, Excellency Director General Clara Cristobal, dear Director Jeffrey Sally, dear friends. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers of today's roundtable for a warm hospitality and excellent arrangement of this event. And I'm so happy to see that your faces resemble much the Kazakh faces, which give me the grounds to go a little bit beyond the official and diplomatic courtesies and protocol, and to start my presentation with the two jokes on unofficial statistics. You know that Kazakhstan, taking into account that Kazakhstan's territory is the ninth biggest territory in the world and relatively small population. In the ancient times, we were nomadic tribes riding horses, taking our herds of sheep, horses, and cattle, roaming from pastures to pastures. And of course, the main foodstuff was for us was lamb, cattle, and the horse meat. And there is a statistics that, because I, for example, can eat lamb three times a day, year round. And there's the statistics that Kazakhs hold the second place in the world on consuming meat. And you guess who is the first one? The first one is the wolves. The second joke is about the 2012 Olympic Games in London, where we, for the first time in our history, we have won six golds.
Seven
goals, and by general statistics, we were 11th or 12th.
12th.
And China was the fourth. What I did, I collected all medals and divided it per capita. Oh. And it comes that Kazakhstan is the first and China was 54th. His Excellency Ambassador Orasbay already outlined the major political aspects of my country's domestic and foreign political agenda. Allow me to dwell upon some of them more deliberately. From the very beginning of our independence, the leadership of my country has been adherent to the fundamental principles, economy first, politics later, although it caused some pressure on the part of certain democracies in the world. And another important guideline of the domestic policy was creation of a new nation where people would live in peace and concord. Actually, both goals were extremely challenging. After the crumble of the Soviet Union, most of the former Soviet republics experienced economic hardships. Some of them went through bloody interethnic conflicts and civil wars. Fortunately, this was not the case of Kazakhstan, and 25 years later, we can state that we succeeded in setting up and developing our statehood successfully. Thanks to a strong leadership and vision of President Nazarbayev, my country is being developing according to the nation's long-term master plans. The first one was Kazakhstan 2030, which was launched in 1997 with the goal of joining the club of 50 developed economies of the world. And there were so many sort of pessimistic views of some neighboring countries that how the countries of former Soviet Union are in stagnation period, and now you have to think about the immediate needs, but you are thinking about 30 years ahead. But this plan has been completed in my country by 2012, so it's more than half of that period we managed to cover the path of 30 years. That is 18 years earlier than scheduled, we have completed that plan. And this, of course, was the good grounds to initiate by my president the next program, Kazakhstan 2050 strategy, which meant to bring my country to the list of top 30 countries. The previous program fulfillment helped my country to become among the 50 top economies in the world. In line with this new strategy, we have been working hard on implementing the new economic policy, which is called Nur Lijol, or Sacred Path, which is a 9 billion economic stimulus plan to develop and modernize roads, railways, ports, IT infrastructure, education, and civil service.
And that's why we have to protect our country from unwanted or illegal possible migrants. That's why the regulation for visa to Kazakhstan, I agree, is relatively strict and it's serious. But the reason is understandable, I'll tell you. We are neighboring with so many overpopulated countries who would be happy to come and to settle. That's why we have to protect. But it does not apply to Philippines because you are far away from Kazakhstan. It's not easy even to people who want to go and to settle to come because it's very expensive, unlike neighboring countries. That's why it requires negotiations and signing of MOU. I hope that we will consider the possibility of doing so with Department of Foreign Affairs in future. But now we don't have any visa relaxation for the Philippine citizens, unfortunately.
With regards to transcripts of the grades, as I told you in my presentation, we are going to be trilingual society. And from 2019, our 10th and 11th grade students will learn English. We are having a dozen of universities in Kazakhstan, including the biggest one, Nazarbayev University, which is run in English. And the 70% of the staff is faculties from abroad. And everything is in English there. Now we're increasing. This means that the good opportunity for foreign countries like Philippines to come to teach us English there. And of course, all of us can't miss globalization. These international standards of teaching at the universities is spreading around the world, and taking into account that a dozen of our universities follow that model, then this transcript will be no problem in the nearest future, will be no problem for transferring the credits from Manila University to Kazakh and vice versa. And our Minister of Education is working hard on it, trying to modernize and reform the educational system in my country.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We are privileged to have with us today Undersecretary Manuel Antonio J. Tihanki, to give us the keynote address and to welcome us to this afternoon's session. To introduce Undersecretary Tihanki, I would like to call on Director Mary Grace V. Villamore of the Regional and Bilateral Economic Relations Unit of the DFA Office of the Undersecretary for International Economic Relations. So, Director Villamore.
Good afternoon, everyone. I trust everyone had a lovely lunch, and it's my pleasure to be the one to introduce to you our Undersecretary for International Economic Relations, Manuel A.J. Tihanki. Ambassador Manuel A.J. Tihanki is currently our Undersecretary, as I said, for International Economic Relations. He was awarded in 2012 the Department of Foreign Affairs Distinguished Service Award for his diplomatic service as Philippine Permanent Representative to the World Trade Organization in Geneva and Chair of the WTO's Committee on Trade and Environment. In private practice, he has acted as International Counsel for clients, and he had also served as Undersecretary of the Department of Justice and Acting Government Corporate Counsel. Ambassador Tihanki has appeared before the Philippine Supreme Court, the WTO dispute settlement body in Geneva, the Iran-United States Claims Tribunal in The Hague, and ad hoc tribunals. Ambassador Tihanki lectures as professor of public and private international law at the Ateneo Law School and at the DFA Foreign Service Institute, and at various conferences and seminars. He has been active as a resource person on the political and economic benefits of a shift to a federal system of government for the Philippines. He also serves as the Board of Trustees of the Claudio Tihanki Foundation and Center of the Rule of Law. Ambassador Tihanki graduated with honors with an AB in Economics at the Ateneo de Manila and Ateneo Law School as valedictorian gold medalist. He also took his Master's of Law at the Michigan Law School as a DeWitt Fellow and at the London School of Economics and Political Science as a Chevening Scholar. May I introduce, to give us the welcome remarks for the afternoon session, Ambassador and Undersecretary Manuel A.J. Tihanki.
Excellency Ambassador Oresby, Excellency Ambassador Suleiman, our friends from ASPAC led by Assistant Secretary Tinta, our friends from FSI led by no less than our Director Cristobal. Dear colleagues and friends, it's my pleasure to be here today in what is a first in terms of enlarging, growing Kazakhstan-Philippine relations. I do have a few introductory slides by which I think for the keynote to put in perspective your discussions in the morning relating to Kazakhstan's background. In terms of, I understand we have a varied audience here from various Philippine agencies. Of course, mostly from foreign affairs. And to put in context, I come from the economic unit. And of course, thank you to Grace. Oh, of course, embarrassing, thank you for the kind introduction. Though from the economic unit, we have a desire for shorter and sweeter introductions, but I appreciate your leading the way.
You said that it was one-tenth of your biography.
But it is a great pleasure to be here. And as our moderator probably knows, we are pushing in the economic unit non-traditional markets. And of course, having no embassies yet among our two countries, we are indeed greatly privileged today to push forward a non-traditional partner and friend in Kazakhstan. Just to put in context, foreign policy considerations where is the DFA and the context of our economic negotiations? Of course, we give due regard. I always say the politicians are in charge. What they say goes, but then the economic and cultural units follow. And sometimes we also do our own insulated or separate work, which can lead to other things. And I'm very happy when I'm dealing with the economic. It's often non-controversial. It's about cooperation and cross-cultural exchange. And again, we can work very hard and very smoothly in the economic cooperation field. As mentioned, I think in the earlier speech today, the success of Kazakhstan was also led by their considerations of economics first, politics later. Of course, in Philippines, politics we acknowledge is first, but us in the economic area must do our best to serve our citizens. So I think in the first slide, just to put in context, our Philippine Constitution, as pointed out by the current administration, is mandated to pursue an independent foreign policy. What that exactly means is quite clear: to put Philippine interests first and foremost. And Philippine interests first and foremost often interlaces with economic interest. And so, why is this so? Because the primary objective of a political organization is the welfare of its people and its citizens. Not too long ago, the United States is also adjusting its independent foreign and economic policy, with President Trump saying US first. So Philippine first is not very far away. It is just protecting local interests in order to enhance the livelihood of and prosperity of Filipinos. And that is not inconsistent with relations of cooperation and harmony and development with our ASEAN friends and neighbors, our traditional allies and partners, and our non-traditional markets and friends. The DFA is put at the forefront of the economic negotiations because of E0459, wherein negotiations of international agreements as part of Philippine foreign policy, and E0292 provides that the DFA co-chairs is the lead agency in advising the president in coordinating a total whole of government approach in foreign relations. We do acknowledge, and this is always important to underscore, the DFA is the lead or co-chair, but we are not the technical economic experts. We defer and support and work with the DTI, the NEDA, the Department of Agriculture, and all relevant departments of government. Again, with the simple goal of deepening and expanding our economic relations. As we formulate and manage the Philippine international economic policies, economic relations is at the forefront of our unit. And how do we do this additionality? By providing inputs and policy support to all our geographic offices, Philippine embassies, and other agencies. There are 85 foreign service posts, and indeed, this is an important pillar of our economic relations. This is where we are able to pursue leads for investment, exports, and import relations. Although we are now quite openly announcing the important strategic interest of the Philippines in its economic relations. Being more substantial as a growing economic power because of our consumer base of 100 million, plus our surpluses in savings and capital, A major shift in most middle-income countries is to shift as well into strategic foreign direct investment and strategic partnerships. I think in Kazakhstan's case, they pursued, of course, they had a rich resource base by which they could build up their capital and attract direct investment through strategic partnerships. The Philippines is now well poised and actually expanding its FDI strategy in all areas of the world, because this is what middle market economies and developed economies always have been doing. Import-export relations is anchored on strategic direct income earning, dividend earning, bang for your buck investment in target countries. So if we move on to our FSPs and DFA, so we are now pursuing through the network of 85 foreign service posts, as well as honorary consuls, and in this case, we would have to interface with our dear ambassador friend in Jakarta. We are trying, of course, to convince, according to Director Cristobal, we are in the process of seeking approval for an embassy in Astana, and of course, we will push that as a major ASEAN economy, we will want an embassy of Kazakhstan in Manila. Why are FSPs important? Because they are the front man of all these economic relations, and economic relations again translates to business and economic activity, and economic activity translates to welfare of Filipinos and, of course, welfare of our friends and partners in Kazakhstan. So in UWIR, as the director, Grace has been joined us within the last year. So Grace has been busy in formulating our strategy for non-traditional markets, and she is in fact in charge of Central Asia and South Asia, wherein Kazakhstan falls part of. So this is one where the additionality of the DFA is firmly at the forefront. Why? DTI, NEDA, all the important agencies, of course, will be very busy with their bureaucratic and technical expertise where they are already very active. DFA has value added here because we are exploring areas where the activity is less. It is less and so less important to many people's eyes. But to a DFA foreign policy or economic policy or strategic policy perspective, these non-traditional markets provide fertile ground for prospective increased business relations, brownie points for any diplomat or government official that is able to expand at a 20-30% clip the events of activity and business development. You cannot get that kind of percentage in your accomplishment report if you are in a traditional market area. So everyone in the Philippine government or even in the business community, we always say, look at the potential numbers. So we are in the, that's why I welcome very much this current workshop, because in the DFA and our economic unit together with ASPAC and other geographic offices, we are just in the process of course, refining, fine-tuning traditional market areas. But in non-traditional, we have to start from scratch. And workshops like this help us to define a comprehensive approach for Philippine-Kazakhstan relations and Philippines-Central Asia relations, or Philippines and ASEAN-Eurasian Economic Union relations. by the end of this day, I think the audience must know what is this Eurasian Economic Union. Going back to Philippines first. What does Philippines first mean to us economic people? It means Philippines at the center of an economic strategy. Philippines has a population base of 102 million with 10 million overseas. We let our Kazakhstan friends know, and that is, they've done their economic homework. Why will they be interested in the Philippines? Well, the numbers speak for themselves. A 330 billion GDP and a consumer base of 102 million and a growing middle class. In the Philippines and many developing countries, there is still a growing middle class. The reason there is a backlash in globalization economics in Europe and the United States is because for the first time in the United States, the middle class has dipped below 50%. And in Europe, the middle class is suffering, and in the United States, they are feeling less prosperous. Then you move to ASEAN, our blood brothers, our partners. So when we say Philippines first, we also mean ASEAN first. ASEAN is our only political, economic, socio-cultural union. This is the strongest bond a country can take. And ASEAN, unlike the EU, is proceeding along the ASEAN way smoothly, by consensus, moderately, and is suffering less the problems that the EU is having, as you can witness today. It is 641 million in population, solid enough. Sometimes we need a billion, but I think 641 is respectable. And look at our GDP as a combined economic force, 2.17 trillion. No one can say anything to that. Not any major power can take that for granted. We do grow to our ASEAN plus three partners. So the next circle is ASEAN plus three with China, Japan, Korea. There is no way this economic region can be disregarded. 2.1 billion population, 18 trillion economy, and you have Japan, China, Korea. So it's an unbelievable Central Southeast Asia economic superpower. Of course, we are experimenting with the plus six with some bumps along the way, but we're trying to smoothen that. That is what you hear in the news on RCEP, an ASEAN-centered regional comprehensive economic partnership. If that succeeds, as the president has directed during his ASEAN chairmanship, that RCEP be concluded, we have a ASEAN plus six economic region, major 5.4 billion population, because of course it includes India, and 22 trillion economy. Beyond that, we're busy enough with Philippines, ASEAN, ASEAN plus three, ASEAN plus six. Where's Kazakhstan? We have the East Asia Summit, which adds Russia and the United States. They are their last circle. And of course, beyond that, we have our traditional partners in Europe and Africa. In the East Asia Summit, with Moscow leading the pack of the East Eurasian Economic Union, there is indeed further circles of partnership with Kazakhstan. And of course, Africa is the last frontier, and Europe, of course, is a competitor economic region. Going now to Central Asia, of which Russia is included, we have the aggregate population where Kazakhstan is involved, totaling a 302 million market with GDP at 535 billion. Is that a trillion or billion? Billion, no? 535 billion GDP. The regional, from this region, including Kazakhstan, of course, Kazakhstan, save Russia, is the major economy in this Central Asia countries. Their top regional exports, of course, are, of course, this is Philippine top regional exports would be pineapple, motor vehicle parts, milk and cream, cigarette paper, and joinery and carpentry of wood. Our experts, like Grace, will tell us what is joinery and carpentry of wood. I wouldn't know. On top regional imports, we import from the area. We have, of course, light petroleum oils, undernatured ethyl alcohol, unusually mandarins, medicament, and other bovine or equine leather. The level of trade is very small. Again, where it is small, we see potential. So it is indeed with great pleasure that I am joining you today, and happy that this will be one of the few steps moving towards increased Philippine-Kazakhstan relations. I am happy to take questions, and I'm eager to listen to the next presentations. And it is true, indeed, seeing all the potential, that we must push forward on improving bilateral trade and investment among our two countries and our two regions of ASEAN and the Eurasian economic region. We have lots of common ground, complementarities that both countries can maximize. And along the way, we can make it an adventure of learning more about each other and of each other's priorities. Our countries can indeed fast track the areas of cooperation, as well as particularly emphasize the potential for energy cooperation. We have partnered with Kazakhstan in the Asia Cooperation Dialogue, in particular in the energy sector, with both Kazakhstan and Philippines being co-prime movers of the working group. So the Philippines is supportive of joint research activities in upstream oil and gas development, and looks forward to exchanging knowledge and sharing of expertise on wind power, engineering, and energy policies. We are indeed keen to conclude the Memorandum of Agreement on Cooperation in the Field of Energy, submitted to Kazakhstan since November 2015. And in trade, we must attempt to build on the basics, coupled with our strategic FDI. Trade expands where FDI expands, so the Philippines is shopping. We are in the market for businesses, strategic footholds in Kazakhstan for investment. Only with this strategic small investments ranging from $2 million to $5 million, as well as strategic investments in the oil sector, ranging from $20 million to $30 million, we would then be well poised to have a footprint in Central Asia. Aside from agriculture and agribusiness, Philippines and Kazakhstan have in common the prioritization of the sectors of manufacturing, infrastructure, and information technologies. There is, of course, the partnership in the Silk Road project that China is spearheading, as well as Philippines has been has subscribed to and was a charter member of the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. During the 2014 political consultation, Kazakhstan also signified its preparedness to undertake tourism cooperation with the Philippines and in Philippine educational exchange, both in the tourism and hospitality industry. We therefore look forward to furthering this tourism cooperation and enhancing cross-cultural ties and knowledge. People-to-people contact, there is no substitute for it, since people-to-people contact engenders educational, cultural, and economic exchange. Apart from the fact that this is sometimes we call the center of the world, Central Asia, so we do look forward in exploring this non-traditional ally and friend of the Philippines. We look forward to indeed expanding our relations. I can thank ASPAC and FSI and of course our two ambassadors for this exciting start of a potential relationship that could blossom. Magandang hapon sa inyong lahat.
So thank you very much, Undersecretary Pihanki, for the keynote address and for underlining the economic policy considerations of the DFA. And just like the speakers during the first session, they were all in agreement, and as reflected during the open forum, that the relations and the partnership between the Philippines and Kazakhstan can still be enhanced. As mentioned earlier, when it comes to further developing and enhancing relations with Central Asia, the first window to be opened is that of Kazakhstan's. And the big room for growth in our relationship includes the area of economy. Thus, the second portion of the forum is focused on enhancing the Philippines-Kazakhstan economic relations. And in that regard, I would like to call, once again, Director Mary Grace V. Villamore to introduce our speaker.
As was mentioned, this afternoon session will focus on the economic profile of Kazakhstan in terms of its GDP mix, degree of competitiveness, priority sectors, and latest economic strategies being undertaken by the government. To present on these, I would like to give to you Mr. Shavkat Sabirov. But before that, may I give a backgrounder on our special guest. He is an expert member of the National Chamber of Entrepreneurs of Kazakhstan, a member of the Social Council of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Kazakhstan, and Advisory Council of the General Prosecutor Office of Kazakhstan. He is also General Manager of the Inspection and Research Services, LTD member of the Board of the National Chamber of Entrepreneurs of Kazakhstan, and Chairman of the Committee of the New Technologies. He has under his belt 20 years of experience in the ICT field. So we lean on him for the next few minutes. Mr. Shavirov, please, the floor.
Excellency Undersecretary Manuel Antonio Tihanki, Excellency Assistant Secretary Millicent Cruz Paradis, Excellency Director General Claro Cristobal, Excellency Ambassador Rosbay, Excellency Ambassador Suleiman, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure to be here. Thanks a lot for inviting me for this great first historical event. Let me just talk a little bit about economy, not a political, just economy issues. As a first slide, I would like just to begin my speech with emphasizing a very well-known fact that the Kazakhstan is a very young country, just 20 years of independence. We celebrated the last year with a stable growing economy. As you can see on the slide, we are ninth largest country, and it's about 9 no, the Philippines has maybe 9 times area of Kazakhstan. And population of Kazakhstan, it's average 9 times less than Philippines. So we have 14 regions plus 2 city Republican significance. The population close to 18 million. So population density in Kazakhstan, it's 6.5% per square kilometers. Compared to Philippines, it's 333 people. So we have a nice opportunity. Let's see at the picture, it's GDP. At the bottom of the graph, we have a GDP from the Central Asia countries and Euro-Asian Economic Union, except Russia, of course. So I just try to show you that the difference, the gap between Kazakhstan and other countries. But you see, GDP, it's really close, GDP of Kazakhstan is really close to Philippines. Here is just graphs of GDP to countries from 1990 till 2015. You see, at the first 10, 12 years, when the first 10, 12 years of independence were spent for creation government system and massive economic reforms. So from 2002, Kazakhstan and Philippines is growing up. Financial crisis at 2008 and 2009, just give me this. And of course, as a crisis from 2013-14, financial crisis 2008-2009 brought for us as a result in dropping GDP just based on exchange rate for between the local currency tenge and GDP as well. This is statistic data from the National Bank of Kazakhstan for the last year GDP structure. It means we have 55% of GDP which came from services. The second is 13% at mining, 11% manufacturing, and transport, utilities, construction, and agriculture as well. So for GDP per capita in US dollar, you can see the same graph, which is going a little bit down in for the last 3 years. Let's see for doing business for 2016. Kazakhstan became as a Kazakhstan ranks 35 in the world ranking of doing business, 25th place in the ranking on protecting minority investors. And for the global competitiveness index ranking, we are 53rd in the global competitiveness ranking. And what we have with the natural resources, let's see through the worldwide reserves in Kazakhstan. We are first for the presence of chromium, the second place for uranium, fifth place for presence of silver, and you can see other graphs. And what about the worldwide production? Kazakhstan is the first country for production of uranium, the third one for the chrome, ninth for the zinc, and other. As you can see, Kazakhstan looks like a table of elements over the world. So we have enough resources. And there are six priority economic sectors highlighted by government of the country, including metallurgy, chemical industry, food industry, petrochemical, production of construction materials, and machinery as well, for the last one. There is a number of particular investment preferences offered by the government to potential investors, such as exceptions from custom duties, in-kind grants, the next one, it's free entry, visa-free entrance from January 1st, 2017. Unfortunately, there are no Philippines for visa-free, unfortunately, sorry. Yes. Free work permit for foreign labor without permit for the duration of construction plus 1 year after commissioning of the investment project for those with investment contracts. The next one, we have tax exceptions. It means corporate income tax come to zero for 10 years. Land tax for 10 years, it's still zero. Property tax for 8 years, it's zero. And also, we have a cashback on your investment, up to 30%. Additionally, to stimulate the economic activity of the certain regions, the government of Kazakhstan has decided to organize special economic zones throughout the whole territory of the country. Therefore, currently there are 10 special economic zones exist right now, which are supposed to be used for particular sectors of economy. You can see at the west of Kazakhstan, we have a special economic zone for petrochemical industry. We have a special economic zone at seaport Aktau. At the south of Kazakhstan, we have a park of innovative technologies, special chemical park, and textile industry. And also, at border with China, we have a special economic zone, Horgos Eastern Gate. And of course, we have on the north, as I said, we have a 10 special economic zones. What about infrastructure? As we discussed before, the first half of our event, we spoke about Silk Road, the transportation. It comes from Lianyungnan, from a Chinese seaport, and also it's the total Silk Road from China to the west of Russia, it's 8.5 kilometers and about 2.7 thousand kilometers it comes through the territory of Kazakhstan. So the Kazakhstan geographical position makes it international crossroads for major transit corridors from the east to west, from the north to south. And also there is a territory with a population of more than 3.3 billion people within a radius of 2,000 kilometers. So this is our one of the biggest project with China, Russia, just to provide the road from Western China to Western Europe. Just an example for taxation comparison with China and Russia. For corporate income tax in Kazakhstan, we have 20% is the same as in Russia and China. For value-added tax, but we have a 12%. China 17 and Russia 18%. And property tax, we have just 0.5. And land tax, it just depends on square meters. I don't remember how many months ago our president just declared about the 10 concrete steps set out by President Nursultan Nazarbayev to implement the 5 institutional reforms. The first one is transparency and accountability of the state. The second one is industrialization and economic growth. The third one, creation of a modern and professional civil service. The fourth, ensuring the rule of law. And the fifth, a unified nation for the future. For us, it's more important today just to see the second one, industrialization and economic growth, which comes to institutional reforms. So the step number 55, 56, 60, 61 directly related to investment policy. As the first one, it's involving at least 10 TNCs in the processing sector for the creation of export commodities and out of Kazakhstan's world markets. Here is just brands and logger companies, what we already have in Kazakhstan. Step number 56, creating priority sector of joint venture with the anchor investors, international strategic partners. Step number 60, attracting strategic investors to develop the production of milk and dairy products. And the last one, 61, attracting a strategic investment for the development of production and processing of the meat. Here is the last numbers of investment in Kazakhstan. As you can see, the largest investors in Kazakhstan is the Netherlands with $5.7 billion in 2015. The second one is US. The third one is Switzerland, France, China, and just going. The total amount of investment to Kazakhstan. It's $14.75 billion per year. So we have also success stories. There are a lot of commercial brands. And let's talk about tourism market as the last questions. As I said, we have about 18 million population and about 11 million as a tourist. So we have about more than 10 million people who are traveling to CIS country. It means Russia, Uzbekistan, Belarus. And about 1 million people who are traveling to other countries. So it means the total, we have more than 11 million tourists. Useful links. Of course, we have Ministry of Investment and Development of the Republic of Kazakhstan, e-government. We have a special agency, National Export and Investment Agency, Kaznex Invest. We have a special website where you can find all priority projects in Kazakhstan through the website www.invest.gov.kz. And if you need any numbers or data, official data, you can find through the, for example, National Bank of Kazakhstan. We have it's all data updated every month for the local data and for, according to requirements of the World Bank, every 3 months. So you are welcome. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sabirov. Our next speaker was also part of the morning session. So we would like to please welcome back His Excellency Ambassador Hussein Soleiman to speak on the Kazakhstan Asia Pacific Trade and Investment Chamber. And as was mentioned earlier, the One Belt, One Road.
Dear friends, Ambassador Tihanki, thank you very much for joining us today. Thank you very much for your very fascinating presentation. And it inspired me to think that we are on the right track with creating Kazakhstan Asia Pacific Trade and Investment Chamber, because those six areas of new areas for policy consideration are quite in line with my thinking when we were setting up this body. I would tell you the prehistory of creating this body. Last May, last year, when I was appointed to Singapore, prior to going to Singapore, we received several delegations. One of them was non-resident ambassador of Singapore to Kazakhstan. He is not a politician, he's a businessman. This is a practice of Singapore to appoint non-resident ambassadors to abroad out of businessmen. This guy is a businessman. He has his own business in Singapore and Vietnam. He traveled and met with our dignitaries. A week thereafter, senior minister of trade and industry visited my country, and I was accompanying him to all meetings with our ministers. And what came to my mind during the talks that they were saying that Singapore business does have a little knowledge about Kazakhstan. And that's why nowadays it's very difficult to attract investments from Singapore, while they don't know they don't know almost nothing about Kazakhstan. And it occurred to me that I should fill in this gap. when I came to Singapore, I began meeting with prior pending to present my credentials. I was meeting with big business guys in Singapore, talking to them, and I really found out that they have limited knowledge about my country. And it provoked me to convene to hold the Kazakhstan-Singapore Business Forum. And that drafted the program. The first plenary session would have been augusted by high dignitaries on the both sides. It was Mr. Goh Chok Tong, the former Prime Minister of Singapore, and probably my Prime Minister. Then I wanted to invite very well-known, prominent businessmen or politicians from around the world to be a guest speakers. And taking into account that Tony Blair was an advisor to my president for 3 years and helped my country to move towards market economy, and I worked with his team in Astana. I wrote a letter to Tony Blair and he agreed to be a guest speaker. Lakshmi Mittal, a billionaire who became billionaire, an Indian, due to our steel amalgamation in Kazakhstan, he agreed to come. Jack Ma, Alibaba, who loves my president, he agreed to come. Then we have a council for foreign investors under the president of Kazakhstan, comprising of 33 major companies around the world, among them 9 major oil companies like Total, Eni, etc. We have Marubeni, Mitsubishi, World Bank, EBRD, and I wanted a dozen of them to come and to talk for Kazakhs, not Kazakhs bragging for themselves, but to talk about Kazakhstan because they have their experience in my country. And I dared to ask them to be strict and to begin with deficiencies and wrongdoings in my country, because it's like in a decent business, once lied, then never trusted. That's why it's better to openly talk about our drawbacks and to invite to improve them together. 2 years ago, my president visited UK, and he had a working lunch with 10 tycoons, several trillion. And he used to tell them that, we don't ask money from you. We invite you to come to Kazakhstan to make money together with us and to fix up our infrastructure and to get your profit and become richer. And with that slogan, I'm working with big guys in Singapore. And as for this forum, Kazakhstan-Singapore Business Forum, the next step was to arrange 3 breakout sessions during which our 150 businessmen, which we'll bring to there, they will talk on 5 topics. One was Expo 2017, another is a big national holdings, which is called Samruk Khazna, which is a prototype of Temasek in Singapore. The other one is Kaznex Invest to talk about the investment climate in my country. Another is 10 special economic zones. Another is tourism. And another is, the last but not least, is the startups for the youth. I sent this draft to my ministry. My minister sent it to the office of Prime Minister, and Prime Minister said that he wants to be a guest speaker at this forum. And we began to prepare the official visit of my Prime Minister to Singapore. And we were planning to have that forum in November last year. But unfortunately, in September, our Prime Minister has changed. Then later, late September, the former Prime Minister, who is now Senior Minister of the Government, Mr. Goh Chok Tong, visited Kazakhstan upon invitation of my president. And when he was meeting with our dignitaries and Prime Minister and President, he was saying that we need this forum. And my president said, okay, we need that forum. We will hold it in Singapore, but with obligatory participation of our Prime Minister. And now the new Prime Minister should have some time to get adjusted to his post. And we now postponed it for 1 year. This year, in November, we will hold this forum in Singapore with 200 local business and 150 Kazakh business participating in it. And our Prime Minister will be the main speaker. And now I'm preparing the official visit of my Prime Minister there. When I was thinking about the outcome of that forum last year, I was thinking that it should not be the only just exchange of views. It should be something practical, a result coming out of that. And I decided to go a little bit beyond the traditional things which ambassadors or governments do between each other. Usually they set up the bilateral chamber of commerce and industry, which are headed by representatives of the government, and which are in most part are very bureaucratic and more blah-blahing rather than doing money or investments. And I decided to go beyond that and make it region to region. Kazakhstan Asia Pacific Trade and Investment Chamber, which is comprised not of dignitaries from the government, but from the heads of big business. And my dream was that it would be region to region. And I invited 10 ASEAN countries businessmen to this chamber. I invited businessmen from Korea, India, China, New Zealand, Australia to be co-establishers. And having this headquarters in Singapore as a hub to Asia Pacific area. And Kazakhstan is one of the best economies in Central Asia, could be a hub to Central Asia and the Eurasian Economic Union. The first thing to do with this organization was to have a unified database of big and small and medium businesses in Asia Pacific area, in Kazakhstan, Central Asia, and Eurasia. And to have specialists and expertise in the headquarters who will be making outsourcing companies and bringing B2B, business to business together, and advising them to strike deals and be a sort of quasi-guarantor for them. That was the main thing. Another is to familiarize each other's regions with the possibilities on businesses and trade and investment. That was the major outcome. And I wanted it to be the result of that forum. But as far as we delayed it for 1 year till this, I didn't decide. I decided not to delay it for 1 year. And last December 8th, we launched this body in Singapore. Please, who can help me with next page? Yeah. Next page. And this organization was meant, as I said, among other things. And when in December 8th we launched it, we have already five countries, companies who are the co-establishers of it. Among them, Singapore, Australia, Malaysia, Vietnam, and Kazakhstan. I wrote a letter to the Secretariat of ASEAN to consider this possibility and to invite the other ASEAN member countries to urge companies to join this organization. Because my dream in the future, it will be not captive, it will be Euraptic. Sort of international entity, international organization, full-fledged one, and which will be very much less dependent on the government, but on only business-to-business guys. I think that this is a good platform for nowadays to do so. Especially when I was telling you about that Americans now delayed with Trans-Pacific Partnership. When China came with this initiative on Comprehensive Economic Development Partnership, there's a good opportunity with bringing these regions closer to each other, especially on the level of business here. And this One Belt, One Road is quite in line with this vision. And it may be a coincidence, but the day we opened this organization, next day my president was telling in the interview to the media, saying, why not we change our Minister of Foreign Affairs into the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, as if it was we were thinking like at that time. Because it is the demand of this present time to do so, to avoid political issues rather than paying attention to economic cooperation, which cements our relations. Brings us closer to each other. As for the of the missions, of the mission of this thing, out of those points which I mentioned to you, the goal to introduced this organization was to form and nurture highly respected forum for an organized continuing basis in which business and business people in Kazakhstan and Asia Pacific can discuss and identify common economic and commercial interests. I have already had such experience when I was Consul General of Kazakhstan in Hong Kong. In 2008, we arranged Kazakhstan Hong Kong Business Forum called Investment Climate in Kazakhstan and Investment Opportunities of Hong Kong. We brought 120 Kazakh business. We held this forum, and the result was that in a week we opened a direct flight between Hong Kong and Almaty, and the second was that we signed a 2 weeks visa-free regime agreement. And if we hold this forum in Singapore, similar one, we're hoping for the same thing, because we are planning to open the direct flight Astana Singapore in January 2019. And now we propose to them a draft of the bilateral agreement on 30 days visa-free regime agreement between our countries. Also, we are about to sign the bilateral investment treaty with this country. Another reason was to create this chamber, was to initiate projects or events as necessary to promote and raise the profile of business in Asia Pacific, Central Asia, and the Eurasian Economic Union. As I told you, that the initiator of the Eurasian Economic Union was my president. It took 22 years for him to struggle to bring this idea to come true. And 2 years ago, Vietnam signed an FTA agreement with the Eurasian Economic Union. Last month, the Vietnamese are very hard drinkers of vodka. We have very good quality of vodka because it is made of hard wheat, hard class wheat of Kazakhstan, which is high quality. And very, very good quality. And last month, the two trains of vodka were stuck in Ho Chi Minh in Hanoi. It is because they didn't ratify the FTA with the Eurasian Economic Union. Whenever they heard that so much vodka is stuck there, it really took 2 days for them to ratify, and now all Vietnamese enjoy vodka. Last year, Singapore has initiated negotiations on FTA with Eurasian Economic Union. Last year, it was China and South Korea. They also initiated negotiations, and I hope within the next several years, we'll have them sign FTA with us. I'm very wanting that all ASEAN countries will sign FTA with Eurasian Economic Union. Then you'll enjoy not only vodka. We're a producer of very good quality of cognac. Our cognac is made on French recipe with spring water. We managed within several 5 years, last 5 years, to produce our red dry wine, which is like Chilean nowadays, very good quality. From my youth, I adored Belgium and Swiss chocolate. But for the last 10 years, Kazakh chocolate is better by quality and more tasty, because it's more of natural organic things. And taking all into account this development of our trades, my dream is that you sign an FTA agreement with the Eurasian Economic Union, and we will bring to you vodka, cognac, especially alcohol, because when you drink, you are more kind to us, actually. And another goal of this CAPTIC was to arrange, on a regular basis, to arrange forums where we can meet each other and discuss, and maybe probably on the sideline of this forum, we can sign agreements between each other. So it would be a sort of a direct B2B organization, rather avoiding bureaucratic hindrance on the part of the governments. Also, this organization was meant to serve as a voice to represent the collective interests of its members and to provide feedback to the public, companies, or organizations. Also, to complement, collaborate, and cooperate with activities of existing professional groups, and to promote both Kazakhstan and Singapore as gateways to Central Asia. As I told you, that we are now positioned ourselves as a tiger country in Central Asia, and as a hub, like Singapore to the Southeast Asia, we are here. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. There are so many points. So for the building blocks, next one. It was meant to deal pipelines and investor rounds, you know, with, that we are very rich in oil. We manage, in order not to be dependent on transporting our oil to Europe via Russia, who dictate their prices to us, we decided to diversify it. That's why it took several years to build the 3,000 kilometers pipeline from the Caspian Sea to Chinese borderline, Natasolashanko. And every year we are exporting to them up to 10 million tons a year, which is a tiny part for the energy hungry China, but still it is good for us to diversify and be less dependent on Russia. We also had for some time, we had a swap operations with Iran. We were delivering to them our oil by Caspian Sea, and they were giving to us their oil in the Gulf, and we were selling it to abroad. So this is also geopolitics together, economics and geopolitics. That's why we were dealing with this. Another is corporate governance and investor rights. It's, you know, our legal system is not ideal because it still has the inheritance of the Soviet style of law legality, which hinders and which is in discrepancy with the world standards. We are now working and improving on them. And in this regards, we go abroad and pick up the best practices abroad. Education, networking, promotion, marketing, consultancy, startups, tourism, and cultural exchange. These are those blocks on which I want this organization to be a full-fledged and to be comprehensive and to deal not only with trade of or raw materials, but with agriculture, with everything. As for the membership, next slide. For the membership, all companies with business interest in Asia-Pacific or Eurasian Economic Union can apply for a membership. Honorary members is to send it to ambassadors only, otherwise the more ministers, the more bureaucracy there. High commission, trade commissioners there. Premium membership offers us a number of exclusive benefits to help to promote this organization in their countries, among their people. Next one. As for the services, I've already told you in general, and we will not stop over the details, and this presentation is available for everybody. You can pick it up. Next one. As for the organizational structure, it doesn't differ much from any international political and business organization. Next one. The Coptic Founder Council, which is at least two entities. By now we have five countries, but I wanted to have all countries of ASEAN to be there, and that's why my humble request to Mr. Tihan Ki, as far as you are the chairman of ASEAN this year, please find my letter which I wrote a year ago, and please invite, urge your partners in the ASEAN to urge their companies to be the member of this organization. Actually, what I'm doing, although there's a financial and economic downturn, I'm building up a platform which will work within several years when we will recover around the world. And by that time, in order not to make it late, by that time there would be a good platform for that, based on which this relations can be quickly developed and purely on economic and business level. Next. This is the same as for the council and board of them. We have the founder council, which is responsible for strategy of the organization. And for the board of the directors, they will be responsible for executing this organization's task. Next one. Thank you.
It's not my desire. It's not even an honor. It's not my pleasure at all to stand between you and traffic. So I'll really keep this very, very short. I have prepared this speech. I don't intend to do this, to read it. I would rather, in our report on this very, very important event, include it. But let me just tell you what struck me the most. throughout these many hours of interaction with our fantastic panel of experts from a partner country that is Kazakhstan. My biggest takeaway is the word pragmatism. If there is something that that is most striking about Kazakhstan as a country, as a nation, as an achiever, it's the fact that they were able to turn everything around in the briefest time possible. It's laudable because it's a characteristic, it's a trait that can only be attached to super achieving people or super achieving nations. You've heard of people who come and first and people who come last. And you have heard of certain people who come last who become first. And there are people who have reached their destination first who, over time, come out last. And the reason for the great success of Kazakhstan is that word, flexibility, pragmatism. If there is one thing that we could learn from Kazakhstan, is to know exactly what is to the country's interests and what can benefit it the most. What has Kazakhstan shown us over one quarter century, not 50 years, not 100 years, 25 years? They were pragmatic enough to actually see that there is no point to make enemies where you can make friends. For much of their contemporary history, it was the Soviet Union. For much of their existence as a nation, it's a wedge between the Soviet Union, Russia,
communism,
and China. But because of that sense of pragmatism and flexibility, they were able now to build great friendship and to derive benefits from a strategic partner called the United States. Are you picking up what I'm trying to drive out? There is only one way for countries that achieve and countries that should achieve more, and that is closely collaborate and find that the friendship and partnership can be made real in the national lives. We don't have to make enemies of anyone. We can make partners and friends with everybody else. So my congratulations, and the guys here, particularly those from trade and industry, from tourism, from even our defense establishment, you guys should be asking the more pragmatic question. What is it that Kazakhstan has that we need? And that is what I would encourage our two ambassadors and Mr. Sabirov as well. What is it that you need that we have? I mean, if you know what is on offer and what is available, then things will start flowing positively in the correct direction. Very often, we Filipinos are so good at knowing what we produce, but we forget to ask the question whether we produce enough of what we produce. In most cases, we offer what we cannot have, what we don't have. China, for a while, we had little dance, song and dance routine. And they stopped buying bananas. All of a sudden, I received, you know, instructions, sell our bananas to Egypt. To why? Only because China stopped buying bananas. And they told me when I was in Hong Kong, sell more of our mangoes. And I was able to cobble up, you know, companies that were willing to import mangoes, only to find out that we don't produce enough bananas for what is there as demand. We don't produce enough mangoes for what is there as demand. In other words, let's find out. And I told already this morning that they produce some things that they produce better, that they produce enough of, that we may need. With Lian Yunggan actually working, and if I got them correctly, it's not yet fully operational. So you know, don't be jumpy. Understand what you're hearing. It will come to pass that it's going to be the most viable way of closing that distance problem between our two economies in terms of goods, products, not services. But once it's fully operational, they produce 70%, they produce wheat and they only use 30%. 70% is available for the world market. We can compete when the price becomes right through a good logistics system. And the same thing, we can start offering what we can produce enough of to them when they tell us what they need. So we must, the good thing about what we started here is a forum, a venue for talking. And that is what we diplomats are good at. And that is what the government agencies represented this afternoon should also be good at, by continuing to communicate and communicating correct answers to correct questions. In other words, not just exploring, and you know, telling stories, or even worse, telling tall stories, non-facts or fake news or whatnot. Ask the correct question, and we hope to get the correct answer and move a 25-year-old relationship into true pragmatic benefit for our two peoples. We cannot thank you enough, and honestly, you'll hear from us again, because I would expect these people from all branches of the Philippine government to start asking the correct questions to you, so that they can in turn feed our business people the correct information that should excite them, because Kazakhstan is an exciting partner for the Philippines.